Last time, we took our first step towards PDEs from ODEs. PDEs, more complicated. Describe continuous effects, effects from continuum sciences, where you have a distribution of mass, where you have, instead of having discrete objects, you now have continuous objects, like a guitar string, like a drum, or like, which will be a very key example for today, the temperature distribution in this room. So we talked a little bit about the wave equation, because one of the more poetic points that I made was that the second derivative is responsible for movement and therefore life. And I like that point. And so we talked about the wave equation, which is all about movement and oscillations. But right now we'll take a little bit of a step back and I'll just give you a little bit of an overview of the kinds of ODEs, excuse me, of the kinds of PDEs that people solve most commonly. So that's the title of today's lecture, and I deliberately skipped the most important word that characterizes all of these ODEs that, excuse me, PDEs, I've got to change, shift gears to PDEs. All of these most fundamental PDEs that we'll talk about. So I just want to give you an idea of the physical problems that give rise to these equations, what they're called, the sorts of solutions that we might expect, the certain approaches that we might take to find those solutions, the common boundary conditions that we would consider, and in some cases, initial conditions, the simple analogies that you can think of from linear algebra and ordinary differential equations. This time I did not misspeak, because some of these are in some ways analogous to ordinary differential equations. And that will give us expectations for what we're going to find. But what all of these equations have in common is characterized by one word that all of you know, obviously, that will go right here, which is probably the most important characteristic of these equations. So anybody wants to guess this word one more time? We had alternative, continuous, totally boring,
conic,
because these are conic sections?
Yes.
Yeah, no.
I'm sorry.
Not conic. More fundamental.
Linear.
Who said that? Hey, linear. I'll put it in when we get there. Maybe they're linear, maybe they're not. So keep this word in the back of your minds. Are these linear? What does it mean? In what sense? And why would it be helpful? And are they? Are they? They are. But maybe not. They are. Okay. So we started by introducing the Laplace operator, or the Laplacian. Some really good words today. I mean, good names. Laplacians. I should write it down. It's another guy who is a privilege to speak about. A very distinguished French mathematician. Worked for Napoleon. Does that sound a little funny? Worked for Napoleon. Makes you long for the times where success was correlated with merit. So this is called the Laplacian. And we know its main property. It meant not so much main property, but its invariant property, something that has nothing to do with coordinates. It is a measure. If you take a function of two variables and evaluate its Laplacian at a point, it gives you a measure of how different the value at that point is from the average of its neighbors. And we know that there are certain functions that we think of in the equilibrium state as being totally averaged out. And the primary example that you should always think of when you hear this is the temperature distribution. Let's take the temperature distribution in this room. Here we would have three variables, x, y, and z, because we live in the three-dimensional space, but you can imagine maybe a two-dimensional space being a good enough analogy. And you would all agree with me that if it's cold there and warm there, then here it'll be average of those two. Some, not average, but somewhere in between. There cannot be a spike in temperature. It's just something, it's just not anything that we've ever experienced. If you were to light a candle, and now there is a spike in temperature right where the candle is burning, if you put the candle out, it will very quickly relax back to the equilibrium. And everywhere, the temperature will be the average of the neighboring values. And you might say, well, that's not exactly true. Look at me. I'm at 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and the room around me is at 70 degrees Fahrenheit. Well, that's right. There are processes inside you that maintain that temperature. You're burning fuel. So it's equivalent to burning a candle. If that process, God forbid, was extinguished, you would quite quickly, or maybe relatively slowly, depending on your material properties, average out. So the temperature in the room is characterized by the fact that its Laplacian equals zero, by zero Laplacian. And it's this equation. So if you imagine that this is your two-dimensional room, the equilibrium temperature distribution, once it's settled and not changing anymore, is described by this, Laplace's equation. This is called Laplace's equation. When you have the Laplacian equals zero, we'll have a lot more to say about this, and that's what we will solve. A few more things I want to say about this. So the equilibrium temperature distribution, you must always say equilibrium. The equilibrium temperature distribution is the quintessential field characterized by zero Laplacian. There's another good word that I'll mention right now. Functions whose Laplacian is zero, in other words, who are at every point the average of its neighbors, are called harmonic. A function is harmonic if its Laplacian is zero. Harmonic. But I have a different example in mind. When I think of harmonic functions, I have an example that's actually wrong, but I find it more visual, so I'll tell you about it. So actually, imagine something in two dimensions. So now we only have x and y. And so the function itself, u, can be imagined along the z-axis. And so the picture would be something like this. And this domain is right here. It will look flatter because we're looking at it from a different angle, but it's the same domain. And so this is our domain of definition. And you're once again beginning to see some of the complexity associated with partial differential equations. It all happens on a domain. And so describing the domain to begin with is something that you need to do before you can solve the equation. So that's complexity right there. Okay? And so the function u you can actually graph it. Because we have three things, x, y, and the function u. It's nice that you can graph it. The temperature in this room, you cannot graph it. You have to color code it because we've run out of dimensions. So I would imagine it on the boundary, maybe having values like this. All right, so imagine that these points all project down to the boundary. Does that make sense? Okay. So we will discover in a moment that this is the kind of equation for which you need to set boundary conditions. In other words, to even begin to attempt solving it, you need to be given not just this differential condition, but the values of the function on the boundary. We'll get back to temperature, and you'll see that that's kind of what we need to do. Okay, and here's what I imagine, even though the system that I'm about to describe is actually described by a different equation, much more beautiful in some ways. Imagine that this is a wire frame that you dipped in a soapy solution and you pulled it out and you imagine the soap film that forms. And you know very well that soap film does not have any bumps, any unexpected bumps. It's as smooth as possible. Some people say that it's as flat as possible. So that's the picture that I have in mind. Actually, this surface, this shape, is described not by this equation, but by something much more complicated. It says that mean curvature, when you study differential geometry, equals zero. But it just corresponds very nicely to my intuition. What harmonic functions don't do is go smoothly like this and then have a little maximum, little local maximum, and then continue. They just don't have those bumps. They're completely smoothed out. You couldn't average it out anymore. That's what harmonic equations look like. Excuse me, that's what harmonic functions look like. And that's my intuition, the soap film is my intuition for what I expect out of Laplace's equation. Now let's talk about boundary conditions a little bit. to find the temperature distribution in this room. There are certain things that you will want to know. For instance, we're talking about equilibrium temperature distribution. For instance, yes, we are here burning fuel, right? That certainly factors into the equilibrium temperature of the room. So if you had to mathematically, not with a thermometer, which is the most direct way of doing it, but by solving a partial differential equation, find the temperature distribution in this room, you would want to know where the people are. Because wherever I am, that's where the temperature is 100 degrees, 98 point. I don't have a fever, don't worry. So whatever it should be, that's the temperature that it is. If I put my arm right here and wait for the temperature to equilibrate, sounds right, then the temperature right here will be 100 degrees. I impose that condition by putting my arm there. And if you want to do some big calculation, you want to know where my arm is. So basically, you want to know all the surfaces where the temperature is given. So, and that usually happens on the boundaries. So you have to be given the values of the temperature on the boundaries, or else you don't have enough information to solve the system. There are very many fields that are harmonic in this room, but only one that has prescribed temperature on all of the boundaries. So you have to know the temperature on the board and so forth. Everywhere, floor, ceiling, I don't know why I singled out the board. There's one alternative. There might be something like a window where you know that the heat is escaping. So if you know the rate at which the heat is escaping across a boundary, that's also a sufficient condition. Now you might say, well, it's getting cooler if heat is escaping. Well, not really, because heat is also coming from the radiator, and there can be a balance. And so on every boundary, you need to know either what the temperature is or what the rate of heat flow is. But you need to, but the entire boundary, one way or the other, you need to know what goes on. And that, and those are called boundary conditions. And I just want to tell you right now that if I were to somehow describe the shape and tell you in whatever way I can, whether it's by equation or just tabulating the values or parametrizing the curve and giving you a function of that parameter, if I somehow prescribed the temperature on the boundary and told you to find a function that satisfies this condition, given this differential condition, given the boundary condition, you would have no idea how to approach this problem. It will actually get a little bit easier, because this is a simultaneous balance of a lot of things. It's not like an ODE where you can start somewhere and then start rolling it. This is a very different thing. This is a simultaneous satisfaction of conditions like this at every point. So you have to somehow solve for all points all at the same time. It's not at all like an ODE. So it's very different, and it's a little bit surprising that we'll actually start right here. And then you will, again, running ahead just a little bit, you might get a little bit suspicious, because I've always said for ODEs that the order of the equation matches the number of conditions that you need. And this is a second order equation, right? There's a second derivative. I'm just looking for an analogy. So you'll see that the analogy maybe doesn't work. Sometimes analogies work, sometimes they don't. So in this case, I just pulled out an analogy that doesn't work. Well, that's interesting in its own way, but it kind of will work. So it's a second order equation. We're dealing with second derivatives in x and also with second derivatives in y. Yet there is only one condition. I don't specify a pair of conditions, what the function is and what its derivative is. So is that a mismatch? Well, we find out that's not a mismatch. It's actually just perfect, because it kind of is like two conditions. If you kind of mentally divide this into two halves, it's like there is a condition on the left and there is a condition on the right. So that will end up being not a bad way of thinking about it, at least reconciling the order of the equation with the number of conditions. There are two sides, always opposite sides, and I'm specifying a condition on the left and on the right. I have to get all the boundaries. The same thing would work with an ODE. If instead of initial position and initial velocity, I specified an initial position and a final position, from whatever point of view you look at ODEs, that would work. You know, because you'll have your C1 times one thing plus C2 times another thing. So you need to determine C1 and C2, and there you have two conditions. You don't really care what those two conditions are. So there is an analogy. Okay, that's all I want to say about Laplace's equation at this point. I will say one other thing. There is a very much a related equation. In this lecture, we'll just keep marching. There are several things I have to say about each one of these equations, so I'll just say them one at a time about each of the systems. We'll come back to Laplace's equation. But there's also Poisson's equation. Poisson's equation, which says Laplacian of u is not zero, but some given function f. What's an analogy? I think an analogy would be a burning candle. And so there is a source, a reason why the function is not harmonic. Obviously, it's hotter where the candle is and colder everywhere around. That's a maximum. It's very much not the average of its neighbors. So when there is a reason, when there is a source, when there is an influx like that, then the harmonicity of the function might break. And so you would deal with a function like this. They're very closely related.